So, a creature for my amusement. Prepare for battle.
Close your eyes, I want to ride the skies in my sweet dreams. Close your eyes, I want to see it tonight in my sweet dreams.
So, you defeated my scouts. Well, my cruisers will destroy you.
Last time, we covered a word that was based in Middle English. Today we're going to discuss a few things about Old English, that is, Renaissance English, that bother me. Mostly because people get them wrong. First, back in Queen Elizabeth's time, some English words were closer to their original Latin roots. A good example of this is the word prevent. We all know what pre means, and if you took French, you can probably guess where the vent comes from. It's from the verb to come. So prevent actually meant, originally, to come before. That is, it used to mean to precede. Over time, coming before came to mean getting in the way of, which eventually led to the meaning for prevent that we have now. Similarly, the word comprehend originally meant to grasp and control, but has come to have connotations of both understanding and overcoming.
You are starting to annoy me, creature. My destroyers will annihilate you.
Second, some words have changed their shape rather than their meaning. For example, throughly has become thoroughly, divers has become diverse, and privily has become privately. They still mean the same thing, they're just longer now. And then there's the spelling of things. Spelling in English took a long time to get solidified. My favorite example of this is the word show. Yes, I know we now spell it show. As I said before, in English, vowels can change over time. I think what's interesting about this word is the words sow and so. Logically, if you spell show, S-H-O-W, shouldn't it rhyme with sow? So why not spell it S-H-E-W to rhyme with so? Then again, there's blow and blue, isn't there? This is why this series is called Why is English So Weird? As if that weren't bad enough, while we're trying to figure out how to spell things, we were also trying to decide what letters to use. In Iceland, they still use this letter, adapted from this rune, which is called a thorn. As some of you may have guessed, it's the first letter in the name of the thunder god Thor, who we also named a day of the week after. Well, English documents from hundreds of years ago also use this letter sometimes. Unfortunately, it never quite made it to the printing presses from Germany, where the TH sound isn't so common, and mostly it's a D instead, and so the closest thing was a Y. Put a Y up a little above the line, and it sort of looks like a thorn, if you know what you're looking for. So when you see a sign saying, ye old shoppy, well, the extra E's and P's are just spelling variants, it's still old shop. And Y-E was never pronounced ye, it was always pronounced the, or the. And of course, it would never appear on a hand-painted sign that way, it would probably look more like this.
You survived! Warships! Dispose of this annoyance at once!
Lastly, and perhaps the thing you may have wondered about the most, is a completely different letter that also sometimes makes the sound th. However, while the thorn typically appears at the beginning of a word, the th always appears at the end. It looks sort of like an integral symbol, and it actually sounds like F with the E. So if you wanted to say, I heareth thee, you'd write it this way. Now, I just lied to you because the F can appear inside a word, like in the Declaration of Independence. So that there, that's an F. No, it doesn't say in Congress, nor does it say in Congress. When F appears inside a word, it's pronounced S, so that word is Congress. Yes, I agree it's weird, but probably no weirder than the double sounds that the letters C and G can have. We have no trouble reading this sentence, now do we?
Our battle is completed, warrior. You were a stimulating opponent.